Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining the Kootenay Conservation Program and BC Chapter of the Wildlife Society for this special webinar featuring Dr. Michael Proctor and Kootenay Connect. My name is Marcy Marr, and I work closely with Michael and manage the Kootenay Connect project on behalf of Kootenay Conservation Program. Okay. And by now, most of you are probably pros with Zoom technology, but if you need technical assistance, please use the chat box found on your toolbar and someone will help you out. And also, if you have a question during Michael's presentation, please use the Q&A box and we'll have some time for Q&A at the end of Michael's presentation. Given the rich heritage of stewardship in our region, I would like to acknowledge that Kootenay Connect occurs on the traditional territories of the Tunaha, Shuekmek, Snakes, and Silks peoples, who have lived in here and stewarded the land and water of this region for many generations. And while some of you are still joining us and settling in, I'd like to tell you a bit about the Kootenay Conservation Program, or better known as KCP. We're a broad partnership founded in 2002, based in the Kootenay region of southeastern BC. And our partnership is comprised of more than 80 land and water conservation and stewardship groups, government agencies, resource industries, and agricultural producers in our region. And our mandate is to coordinate and facilitate conservation efforts on private land and to generate the support and resources necessary to maintain these efforts. And one of our new priorities is to foster a landscape approach to conserving biodiversity, wildlife corridors, in ecological connectivity, and Kootenay Connect is helping us to deliver on this priority. And before I turn it over to Michael, I'd like to invite Bill Harrower to welcome you on behalf of the Wildlife Society.
Hi, everyone. I'm the current president of the BC chapter of the Wildlife Society, and we're really excited to be able to help co-host Mike's talk here with the Kootenay Connect today. The Wildlife Society, or at least our chapter, is a group of professionals from British Columbia and beyond, students, naturalists, First Nations, anybody who has an interest in wildlife. And our goals are sort of consistent with the Wildlife Society in general, is that we want to support active student chapters through the province. And we have student chapters at UNBC in Prince George, TRU, UVic, UBC Okanagan, and UBC Vancouver. And so those groups of student chapters are really our core foundation and sort of drive this interest in professionals. We also do policy development and decision-making support in British Columbia. And so our goal of promoting evidence-based policy development, to support that goal, we work with a variety of people around the province to do that. So part of that process is getting people, supporting people like Michael and their mission in Kootenay Connect. And so we're really excited to help put on this seminar today. Marcy, did you wanna finish introducing Mike?
Sure. Yeah. Thanks, Bill. Yeah, we're really excited to co-host this. And I think we've got a great turnout today for this webinar, a lot of cross-pollinating. And Michael's one of those bees that can cross-pollinate between things. Michael Proctor is an independent research scientist that runs the Transborder Grizzly Bear Project in Southeast BC. Since 1995, he's been using genetic analyses and GPS telemetry to study landscape genetics, fragmentation, connectivity, metapopulation ecology, habitat use, population dynamics, and ecological and food modeling. He's one of those rare biologists that publishes in peer-reviewed journals, works on behalf of the IUCN as a deputy chair of the Bear Specialist Group, and is a member of the IUCN's Connectivity Conservation Specialist Group, and also develops on-the-ground conservation solutions for reducing wildlife conflict and fragmentation. And Kootenay Connect is Mike's latest endeavor that's evolved from his work with large carnivore connectivity and has expanded to ecological corridors centered on riparian wildlife complex, wildland complexes. So thanks, Michael, and I'll turn it over to you.
All right, thank you. So can you hear me, Marcy? Everyone can hear me? We're good?
Yeah.
Well, thanks a lot, everyone. It's really cool to be combining KCP and the Wildlife Society. This is my wife came up with this idea, Corey Lawson, as a kind of a sidebar to the canceled Prince George Wildlife Society meeting. So afterwards, maybe we all go out and have a beer somewhere in your own town, and we'll have a little conference atmosphere. So I'm talking about Kootenay Connect, as everyone has mentioned, and it's really about ecological corridors. And of course, they're important for a lot of reasons, but particularly for climate change. A little bit of study in buzzwords, species at risk, interdigitate here a lot, biodiversity, climate refugia. You'll pick up these themes throughout the talk. I'm part of the IUCN Connectivity Conservation Specialist Group, and they have put together guidelines for ecological connectivity and networks and corridors across the world, led by Jody Hilty. And it's a pretty amazing document. It's not really released yet. This is a pre-copy here. But within those guidelines, they recommend the sort of the formal recognition of ecological corridors into our networks and conservation culture that we're all work towards. And they give a lot of examples of them. I'm going to just talk a few moments about ecological connectivity. It's really the movement of everything everywhere. It's just the movement of nature through and between ecosystems and processes. It's pretty cool. And it's not necessarily defined as a protected area. There's no, you know, we have parks and we have national parks and provincial parks and wildlife management areas, but we don't have ecological corridor designations. But they're recommending that they be considered and defined over some geographical space. And the reason they can't be parks and different things is they often overlap other human activities. And this is sort of the important part. We're talking about managing and considering the matrix between protected areas. So we're looking at places where there's farming and forestry and hunting and all the different activities, but we want to manage them for both wildlife connectivity and some humans. And, you know, I'm sure everybody on this webinar would probably agree we need to manage all our lands for wildlife and natural values plus humans. So I gave this talk originally to the government a couple of weeks ago, and I wanted to stamp into the idea here that it really is a combination of private and public lands, mainly because animals don't differentiate the two. They use both, and we'll see a lot of that in this story. This is an old slide I built about 5 years ago to talk about large-scale connectivity projects going on around the world. And many of these are centered around carnivores. If you can see my cursor, lions in Africa and a lot of jaguars in Central America, and the Great Barrier Reef out here, and then even on the Eastern Australia, Bhutan, which has 50% of its country protected. And then the green, it's also linked by designated corridors. So, and then in North America, we have Y2Y. But since then, there's been a sort of an explosion of this ecological corridor idea, a little bit like what happened to me in my mind when I went from grizzly bears to ecological corridors. Everyone started looking at it in a broader perspective rather than just through the lens of one carnivore or one animal, often considered as an umbrella. So these are just an example. These are examples in that IUCN report about all the ecological corridors that are happening around the world. And it's pretty amazing. So the point of this is that it's not just here in the Kootenays, but we're sort of, this idea is growing around the world, and it's sort of time has come. But as most of you guys know, I'm a grizzly bear biologist, or at least I was for many years, for the last 25 years, actually. So I'm gonna just give you a little more background of how this evolved in the Kootenays. And I think it's a worthy story. Sorry to have to talk about bears, but you know, just for a little bit. But at any rate, part of the work I did was, a lot of you are aware, we published a wildlife monograph about large scale fragmentation of grizzly bears across basically Western North America. And this is a zoom in where all the action is, where all the fragmentation is. Those yellow dotted lines represent where female bears are limited between moving between populations, mainly by human settlement and traffic patterns and all that. And what's causing that mortality is mostly conflicts in the settled valleys with the people, not necessarily traffic, a little bit traffic, but mainly bears getting lured into human foods and getting killed over a period of decades. And then next thing you know, the populations are fragmented. They've created those patterns of mortality. You can see in Southeast BC here, have created sort of these walls of mortality. This is the mortality of non-hunt mortality of bears over several decades in Southeast British Columbia. And you can see that it's hard for a bear to get across this Elk Valley Highway corridor or the Cranbrook Eureka area without getting killed. And these have created this fragmentation lines in there. But it's also in the backcountry. It's the front country, but the backcountry, and it's an important part of this story. And as you can see, this map was made with real data, so we knew the population sizes of a lot of the bear populations within the subpopulations here. And there was three really large units that are sort of the more healthy, and I decided 10 years ago when I figured this stuff out, this is part of my PhD, but I would try to work to get bears moving back across those yellow dotted line between those ecosystems and link the small fragments up to the larger healthy populations. I was basically trying to create a job for myself here in Caslow, BC, and it worked out. It was a good idea. We used radio telemetry data and genetic data for the fragmentation work, but to understand where bears moved and let the bears teach us where the corridors might be, I started putting GPS radio collars on bears for a period of, last 15 years. And we put collars on more than 100 bears in this area, and you get a lot of data. It almost looks like the bears are everywhere, and they sort of are. They're in the low elevation valleys and the high mountain peaks and the alpine areas and everything in between. But it turns out they don't cross these human settled valleys very, very much. So we took that telemetry data, did some habitat use modeling, resource selection function, and estimated grizzly bear habitat patches. Those are the green polygons scattered throughout the region. And there's a lot of them, and there's a lot of good grizzly bear habitat out there. But we use those to predict where would bears most likely use habitat to cross the valleys. We've identified that bears aren't crossing the valleys very much, so we had to estimate where they were doing that using least cost path and circuit theory and resource selection function and habitat models. I don't recommend learning that in your 60s. Learn stuff like this when you're 40. This is for all you young folks out there. At any rate, I started my PhD when I was 50, and I think I'm not even sure I'm done yet. I'm almost 94. At any rate, we're going to talk about this little area. I live in Caslow right up here, and we decided to, this population here was the most isolated population in North America, except for the Yellowstone. And so it was a really hard nut to crack, problem to solve. So I thought I'd start there. And my dreamscape was that I could get bears possibly moving from this large population here with maybe 600 bears through the Creston Valley and the suite of this swath of humanity into the southern Selkirks, and they might eventually themselves work their way down into the cabinet. So we would end up healing these this population fragmentation, essentially sort of erasing those yellow dotted lines on that previous map. And so I set out to understand, let bears teach me where corridors were, but then I wanted to help go out and implement conservation management to heal those and actually try to fix the problem. And I, of course, ran up into a wall. As a wildlife biologist, you've all eventually realized that you're working with wildlife and people, the habitat, but you're also working with people. And so that became much more challenged. These three old boys really helped me figure out how to do that. And so I'm just going to talk very briefly about some of the things we did over the last 15 years to help solve that problem, that fragmentation problem. One of the things we did was partner up with a lot of the land trust organizations and purchase strategic lands within these corridors to sort of reduce, the main goal there is to reduce human settlement and human density, so we can sort of give a portion of the valleys back to wildlife so they can move back across there. We purchased, or in land trades, over $50 million worth of land, about 210 square kilometers. It's actually growing since then. It grows every year. It's been an amazing international and working group of scientists, conservationists, land trust organizations, and it's been pretty cool. We're going to zoom in here to Creston a little bit and look in here. you can see this map is just showing you the details within the yellow corridors here. The deep red flame is the best corridor habitat. So we can get pretty specific in here. And you can see that these blue properties were purchased by the Nature Conservancy Canada with a lot of funding help from Y2Y and other organizations, Vital Ground out of the States. And we've kind of, with the combination of the wildlife management area, we've sort of taken back the north end of the Creston Valley back for wildlife. The Creston management area was very good for north-south connectivity, but not as good for east-west, and that's what we've tried to do. One of the other things we've done specifically for grizzly bears was to reduce the conflicts and apply non-lethal management. The bears would come in and get in trouble, and then often they were just killed. So Montana has pioneered a method where they don't have to kill most of the bears. So we just copied the methods from the Montana people, applied it up in British Columbia. And we basically go in and intervene at what I call conflict light bears before they get too much in trouble. And we apply some various techniques. It's good fun, catch and release, grizzly bear harassing. But you can see in here that we have pretty good success rate with the chosen set of bears if they're not too, if not too far down through the culvert of habituation and food conditioning. And another little interesting side fact, I think this is a universal principle. The females caught on a lot more than the males did, so they catch on a little. And I can say that because I'm a male and I know that from personal experience, and I'm sure most of you females out there, you probably know that as well. At any rate, also we have a pretty extensive electric fencing program where we do a cost share so we can share the burden of wildlife management with the whole society and not have it all fall on the shoulders of the farmers and people who live out there with the wildlife. And the farmers really love that. You need to have a 50% cost share so they have some skin in the game and they help maintain their fences, but also society shares in that cost. Been pretty effective. We also, because we're asking the world to tolerate grizzly bears moving through human-settled valleys, we realized early on we needed to give people the tools to occasionally coexist with bears as they move through the valley. So we teach a lot of bear safety education, and we teach bear spray, and it gives people some confidence. We manage we manage airline traffic, we manage vehicle driving, we manage COVID-19. That's what we do as humans. We manage risk, and here's what we're doing. And people are pretty tolerant once they learn these skills. It's a very useful part. And the premise is to include the community in your conservation efforts. And that's what we learned early on. We're the people living in the areas that need the conservation management. So to really bring them into the scene is really beneficial. Another little really cool corner of this story is, and its theme is that we really needed to think about everything. We needed to look at the ecosystem as a whole. We just couldn't look at the valley bottom where the fragmentation was occurring. We needed to look in the backcountry. So we went out and used our telemetry data to model the grizzly bear's most important food in our area, which happens to be huckleberries. It's the driver of population vitality and productivity in our region anyway, not everywhere. And we modeled huckleberry plants using the government data for the Beck system. And it's quite wonderful, but it's, they're sort of everywhere. If you've hiked in the Kootenays, you know that you run into a huckleberry plant everywhere. So it's not a very useful piece of information. But so we used our telemetry data to follow grizzly bears and find the very good huckleberry patches that they used. And then we modeled huckleberry patches important to grizzly bears, a very fine distinction. And this is what we came up with. And the important point here is it's a subset of the larger where plants occur. So only in these bigger patches is it worth a grizzly bear's trouble to use them for their foraging needs for the year. And so that was a very useful thing. And we used that, and this is sort of a trick map. In the previous map, huckleberries were purple. Here they're green, okay? So just to see if anybody's paying attention. And the closed roads in this area are red. So this is the Southern Selkirks, and the roads are all in gray, and the Darkwoods property owned by Nature Conservancy is here, and they happen to own land with a very high density of really good huckleberry patches. And they continued a decades old program to keep most of the roads closed So we had a natural experiment where we could look at, if we close roads in the backcountry where there's really good food supplies, how's that affect the bear populations in the area? And I got to compare that with data in the adjacent mountain ranges and even within this mountain range where there's not so many huckleberry patches. And in a minute, I'll show you how all that worked out. So those are the main things we did for connectivity management. There were a few others. Now we're just going to briefly look at how did all that work. Could we heal the worst fragmentation problem in North America of a grizzly bear fragmentation in the southern Selkirk? So we'll just go with this map right away because it's in our memory. And our little comparative analysis with the adjacent mountain range showed that we had higher densities of female bears and males, but mostly females, what we care about, in those areas, and that those females had higher successful reproduction. We have a fitness layer across this region, so we can link them up to areas where there are high huckleberry patches and low road densities through closure or just naturally. So that was a pretty powerful piece of information. And here we're talking about the backcountry, so we're trying to help this population. And this, what this has to do with connectivity is we're connecting bears to these very good habitats. You don't want a bridge to nowhere. You want a bridge to what's really useful out there to the organisms. And also our mortality work, you can see this is pre-2006, before we implemented our program. We had a lot of data before then, but this is the mortality pattern before 2006. And this is after we implemented our work. It's not a perfectly statistically significant pattern, but it shows the inflection point, and we think that it's indicative of our management efforts. This, to help convince myself of that, I looked at the adjacent valley in Fernie, Sparwood, and Elkford, which has a lot of bears and a lot of people, and the patterns are still increasing there. They did not put in the spectrum of programs that we did, so it helped convince me that what we're doing is kind of real. In terms of connectivity, we use radio telemetry to also measure where bears moving into the, this is the southern Selkirks, which is completely isolated. We caught a bear here, hide, put a radio collar on him, and over 2 years, he actually moved into here. We hadn't had bears moving into this population for about 70 years. So there's one line of evidence. We have a few other more bears since then who have moved into the Selkirks. But that's not gene flow, or that's just a male bear moving into a population. So next we looked at all the genetic samples we've collected over the years and done a source assignment analyses. And you can see imagine the Creston Valley is right down the middle of this graph. And these are the Purcell bears. And here are the Selkirk bears. They're quite clustered together. And there's been a few migrants mainly moving out from the Selkirks in the times past. And most of these bears ended up dead. That's how we have their sample. But since 2006, we can see three or four migrants moving into the Selkirks. These bears were captured in the Purcells, but their genetics say they were born in the Selkirks. Very powerful tool. So you can see this, another line of evidence with almost all the bears that we've sampled in the region over the years. A really neat increase in movement into that, but that still isn't gene flow, real connectivity. Connectivity requires, I say affectionately, movement and sex all together. So you have to have animals moving and then they have to breed. So we have another line, our last line of evidence, which is really exciting to me. I'm a bit of a nerd here, but we caught Bob and Maeve. We put radio collars on them and they begat Captain Hook, who personally moved across into the southern Selkirks where we caught him and put a radio collar on him. But with his genetics, we found out that he had not only moved there, but he mated with five other females and had about 10 other kids. So this is gene flow. This is population rescue. This is everything that we are trying to manage for. Doesn't get any better than this. We have four families that are actually doing this. We now have just recently a female who's moved over and done the same thing, mated with several males and had four offspring. So we're looking at population rescue. It's pretty exciting after all this time. It's since 70 years of isolation. So when you throw all that evidence together, this is what we had pre-2006, and there was a lot of data that went into looking for bears that moved here. It's not just a matter of more data. But we had a few movements of bears here and there, but since then, in the 11 years, we've had a lot of movement. So we're thinking it's happening. We're pretty excited. And all this is in a paper that we've written. It's published in Human Wildlife Interactions. If you guys have, anybody here has insomnia, needs to get to sleep better, I recommend you download this, you read it, and it puts you to sleep really quick. So anyway, it was pretty interesting. This is back to my little dreamscape. It looks like this is actually happening. We're seeing the connectivity occur across these. And we actually are seeing bears drift down into the cabinets now. We can't get them to stay alive yet, but we're working on that. It's a slow process of a couple of decades. So this is the arena where all that happened, the Creston Valley Wildlife Management Area. And it's a really amazing wetland riparian complex, a Ramsar wetland site recognized around the world. And it started my brain thinking about what goes into a bear corridor. And also it started me thinking about private land and how the conservation arena of the future and now is really in private lands. And both the BC government and the federal government have indicated and found, they're hesitant to put a number, but they say a high proportion of species at risk are found in the private lands in the valley bottoms. And if you look at that, this is a map of the private lands in the map, and you can see it's just pretty solid. I actually didn't put the US in here, I've subsequently made it, and it's the same. It's just solid in here. So this is the challenge of landscape connectivity and wildlife management. And remember, I said we need public lands and private lands. This is where connectivity will happen. This is where species at risk enhancement will happen, all on these private lands. And what we have to work with here is somebody had the foresight to put in the management area. So it gives us a matrix of somewhere to start. And as I mentioned earlier, we saw this map, the conservation properties bought by the Nature Conservancy and others and managed by them for connectivity in that area. So we're trying to take back a little bit of that private land. And there's another story in the overlays this that caught my eye. This is the northern leopard frog habitat and the study area in the Creston Valley. And at the same time we were working bears, the leopard frog people were out there working. And they have little corridors within this valley where they move between their overbreeding places and their foraging and breeding spots. This is their overwintering area. And they move around inside that corridor and overlaid that. Of course, there's the connectivity lands that we purchased for bears, but we're also really doing some benefit for the frogs. And so John Krebs and I, you guys probably know him back when he was with FWCP, we're sitting in the office looking at this stuff and christened this area the Frog Bear Natural Area. Because it had the, it was of course the grizzly bear corridor, and that allowed us to, the charisma of the bear, however annoying that is, allowed us to raise some money for the leopard frogs. And, so right now, down on the bottom of the Creston Valley, you drive down there and you'll see this big sign that the Nature Conservancy put out, sort of laying out this story, mentioning some of the players, and it's become this corridor, and the town and the area has sort of accepted this, that they live in a corridor, even though it's private land, a lot of it's private land, and it's not necessarily designated officially, but it sort of is unofficially. And this stuff was brewing in my mind as I got to know the larger Kootenay area over the years working and recreating. And so here's a riparian layer in the Kootenay, in the Creston Valley that I built that identifies riparian habitat. The yellow is a grizzly bear connectivity. I did a simple overlay where they intersect, and I found, wow, it's a nice strong intersect between grizzly bear corridors and riparian areas. And then I thought, let's just try that across the whole Kootenay region. I won't drive you through it all, but here's the riparian areas, there's the grizzly bear corridors, and there's a lot of overlap. And most of the big grizzly bear corridors went through and overlapped a big riparian area. So we identified some of these hotspots. And about this sometime a few years ago, I started bringing this to KCP and Juliet and Marcy, and we all started talking about it and drinking a little beer and discussing the idea, and came up with the idea of maybe we should start a project called Kootenay Connect. And but here, I wanna stop for just a moment and go back to an extended introduction, if you will. I really wanted to make a link in my mind, because to me, science-based conservation is everything. So I spent quite a bit of time researching, were riparian wetlands, what did they have to offer? Do they really have high biodiversity and higher species richness? And I found quite a few papers that showed locally and around the world that it seems to be a generally accepted principle. And But they also, not only they hold species that use them all the time, obligate riparian species, but they have a lot of species that use them for some portion of their seasonal, yearly, annual needs or their home ranges. And then there were some papers that really got even bigger and taught me that to really manage for biodiversity in a holistic way across a large region, we really needed to think in a landscape perspective. And we needed to start linking our riparian wetland stuff with our uplands. And this was growing in my mind. And then in the end, I became a co-author to a paper to Rick Howard. You guys have heard about him. He's a wetlands gravel bed river genius. And he gave a webinar not too long ago about this whole topic. But this graphic out of our paper in Science Advances is a pretty neat paper, but it shows the, you know, I call it bugs to bears, all the biodiversity. They made the claim that up to 70% of the biodiversity happens in these wetland areas. But when you consider all the links up to elk and wolf and all the way up to grizzly bears use those habitats for their spring needs, but they also use it for connectivity. It's a pretty impressive paper that gives you a feel and it rounds out this whole idea. So we started exploring, I started exploring the idea of establishing these recognized functional corridors, with private and public lands, and it still doesn't have a perfect mechanism within our society, within governments, so the various levels of governments and public and private lands. But I'm dedicated to trying to solve this problem. And this is a sign of, this is the corridors. This is not what I mean, where we just put up a sign and say it's a corridor over 93 kilometers. It's maybe a little too big. I was sort of hoping that we can identify these corridors that we can strategically put on our efforts. And I just took this picture like 3 days ago at the Columbia Wetlands, and this is a farm that's right up above the Columbia Wetlands, right adjacent to it. And it really shows the link between how public and private lands are interlaced in the Kootenays, as they should be. But anyway, the point is, what we're looking for is not really a park, but it may have some other designation that includes both of those. And, just to jump ahead, I'm going to cheat a little bit here, but we've had some amazing progress on developing. I thought private lands would be the most impossible or most challenging arena to bring up this idea, but in talking to the RDCK, that's the Regional District Central Kootenay and East Kootenay, talking to their planners and their some of their elected officials, they already have a mechanism for it in their development permit areas of ecological sensitive areas. So they were very open to the idea that and they already have connectivity identified in their community plans, the mechanism for this. So they were very interested in receiving more detailed information on where appropriate corridors might be. And this could be part of the arm of a corridor across a region. And this would be part of the implementation of private lands. Also, of course, the KCP is involved in private land stewardship with certain farmers, and Farmland Advantage is a cool program that integrates farmers and biodiversity management. So there's a lot of mechanisms for private land. I was amazed. So, and also public lands, that's why I gave a talk to the government last week, a lot of the higher ups and lower ups. And we talked about, what would it look like for a public land? Seems a little easier there, because you're still allowing human uses on public lands. It's just a matter of managing them a little lighter, so it's a little more wildlife friendly. So we developed Kootenay Connect, this idea with Marcy and Juliet and I, and then some others, and it's blossomed. It's really a blend of science and community-based approaches. We really wanted to, this is the beauty of Kootenay Conservation Program. They have like 80 members and groups that are members. And we put in an initial grant to Fish Wildlife Compensation Program for 3 years. We get based on annual approval. We've been funded for 2 years. We are very grateful to them to develop this idea. And with some KCP money, we ended up writing, Marcy and I wrote a preliminary report to put out the concept. And then this is either good or bad. You got to watch what you wish for. An opportunity came along to apply to the Nature Fund, and we secured a $2 million grant over 4 years. So we went from the chairlift to the downhill really fast in this. We are skiing downhill full speed. at this point. The neat thing about the $2 million is it's designed for implementation and restoration work on the ground. So we've been quickly integrating the two different projects. One's overarching planning, the other is implementation. And, you know, from Environment Canada's standpoint, it ticked off a lot of their boxes, our project. We were kind of amazed that we won a competitive, we won a slot. But it, you know, they're really interested in species at risk and biodiversity. And, you know, they're also in the buzzwords and connectivity, climate resilience, and indigenous people collaboration. And they have a strong species at risk focus. And of course, all these things are interwoven, as you guys all know. So we had to among ourselves, understand how all this fit together. So we put a little flow chart. I apologize for this, but you can just see that Kootenay Connect original, we call it, is built off this FWCP grant. And we decided to chop up the Kootenays into four areas that we'd approach each year to consider them and plan and help organize and identify and help implement conservation, connectivity and landscape connectivity. And so we had this early success where we got the $2 million over 4 years. We decided to apply that to these four areas so we didn't just stretch ourselves so thin. And now we're in the beginning of year two, and we're going to continue on to these other eight areas. You can see, like, we're going to focus on the Lardo, Duncan, and Columbia Lake, et cetera. So we have our work cut out for us. It's been a really great ski. So there's, like, so far we have like 66 sub projects within the larger Kootenay region in the four designated focal areas that we're working on with the Nature Fund grant. And we have the largest wetland in the region, and it's a monstrous wetland, 120 to 160 kilometers long. And then we have maybe a smaller one in the Bonanzas. But we chose these four areas that were already being worked on generally. There was a stewardship group that was interested in, and enthused and smart and integrated. So we asked them if there was anything we might do. And of course, we helped them raise some money, and we worked with them to try to plan. And so some of those projects that we're working on, I can't go through them all. There's like 66 of them, you know, that we've got over the 4 years. But they include wetland restoration and hydrologic connectivity, inner wetlands hydrologic connectivity. And really what that means is slowing the water down and connecting that wetland so it becomes climate resilient. It holds water longer, and it allows the wetland creatures to move around a lot better. You'll see an example a little bit later. But we're also doing species at risk habitat assessments and trying to integrate those into a habitat-based approach. We're also working on upland connectivity, not just grizzly bears, but we're doing some western toad stuff and ungulates and a variety of critters. And we're also really integrating the Nature Trust of BC and Nature Conservancy. We're looking at some analyses of where we could look at some more strategic private land ownership and purchase. Anyway, it's a pretty exciting, very broad, ambitious endeavor. And this is just to give you a flavor. So this is just not me and Marcy and Juliet on a computer. These are the organizations that we work with regularly. It's not just like we talk to these guys occasionally. We work with a lot of organizations, and even more, Kootenay Conservation Program has more sub-organizations. But these are some of the individuals, a lot of Flinereau biologists that we really seriously integrate. We're talking to them on the phone. We have workshops with them. We Zoom with them. So it's really a community, a Kootenay community effort. And we have an amazingly rich conservation community here. And this is sort of a little more official. We drew boundaries. We tried to, of these riparian areas, or these, our corridors we're focusing on. And we tried to take them up into the high country. It's not just about the valley bottoms, as you can see. And this is just a quick look at, we sort of identified all the various levels of threatened, endangered, and special concern species, the blue, red, and yellow listed. And as you can see, there's quite a bit of conservation need in these corridors that we're working on. So we went out as part of Kootenay Connect original. We went out and held workshops and brought all the relevant people, including government and government managers and biologists and independent biologists and First Nations and local stewardship groups and elected officials, anybody we could sucker into, I mean, bring into the room to talk about this with us. And there was amazing enthusiasm for coming together and trying to work on this stuff with us. And I'm just gonna real briefly hit on a few of the areas to give you a little flavor. This is the Columbia Wetlands, of course, which is just I just spent 4 days over there with Suzanne Bailey, the sort of the lead retired wetlands prof who understands wetlands like I understand a beer bottle on Friday night. She was amazing. We had an extremely good time. We're bringing together all the resources we can. We've got a GIS specialist, Vivid, out of Vivid Consulting, Marie-Ange Fournier-Beck, and she's been really beneficial in helping us keep a database of all this stuff. And for example, this is the light blue is all the riparian habitat in that valley, that 120-kilometer valley, and the purple is where the private land intersects with that, those wetlands. So those are the hot spots where we might restore wetlands habitat that's been degraded, or we might find that it's an important hot spot for birds or some species at risk, and we might take it to the Nature Conservancy and they might be interested in purchasing it. And they're very interested in working with us on this map. So that's just one aspect of how we're gonna analyze and go look at private land conservation opportunities. And with farmland advantage, I mentioned earlier, also with the planning of development permit areas through the regional districts and stuff. And, you know, for instance, the Nature Conservancy has already purchased a property in this area before we started this. And this is because the Columbia Wetlands has had a little bit less science focused on it over the last few decades. We went out and hired Rachel Darvill, a bird species of risk specialist, to accumulate everything that we know about that whole valley and all the species of risk. She's got a really amazing report as a sort of a where do we stand. So it's been pretty cool. And here's just a quick look where she's identified almost all the different known data-based conservation values we have up and down that valley. There's more out there that are not data-based, but this helps us find out our information gaps and what we know. And for instance, how we might use all that data together, this is some maps that Rachel identified of some hotspots for bird diversity and wetland biodiversity hotspots and species of risk hotspots initially, her first take of it, these four different areas along here. And then we combine that with our private land analysis, and we can identify in each of these areas where we might be able to improve some of these areas if necessary, and look at the private land. So we're going to now do a more detailed look of that up and down the whole wetlands. And it's just an example of how we're bringing together the pieces of information that we can. And to look at Wycliffe, we'll look at another aspect of what we're doing. It's a beautiful, a little bit different type of corridor, sort of a dry grassland wetland corridor matrix. It's an amazing amazing wetland matrices through there, but it's also this dry land habitat. It's a lot smaller. We've identified a sort of a large carnivore corridor through the middle. We actually get remote camera shots of grizzly bears and tracks through here somewhat regularly. It's kind of occurring. And you can see, look at the cumulative effects. We have a lot of different data layers here. It looks like spaghetti. I can't show them all. But this is a everywhere there's a building and a little bit of buffer around there to show you, sort of some of the challenges. This is a cumulative impacts in the area. We're gathering just about all the different types of information we can to bring it together to help us understand what our opportunities and what our tools are and where we might, what the threats are as well. And this is just a map example of something I mentioned earlier about the private land regulation through the official community plans with the regional planners. They've come to us and we talk to them semi-regularly, not regularly enough. I've been a little negligent lately, but we look at providing some of the information that we're putting together that they can put that into their helping define ecological sensitive areas so they can control them with these development permit areas. And they're really hungry for the information. They're just as enthused as we are. It's a neat partnership. We're also in that area that we've commissioned this year through the Nature Trust and the Nature Conservancy of Canada, some specific habitat restoration activities for the Lewis woodpecker and the Williamson sapsucker. And in the next year or two, we'll actually implement those recommendations, how we could enhance those habitats. And in the Bonanza area, we also have some wildlife corridors identified. It's a smaller area, a little bit easier to identify those areas. And we also have cumulative effects maps. And what's happening there is they're actually restoring some of the wetlands that have been disturbed through some human activities over the last decades, railroads, and they have an old rail trail that has sort of cut the wetlands in half. So we're weaving it back together so it can function better as a wetlands area. But also they're doing a beaver survey to identify beaver activity past and present to sort of have an enhancement so we can have some natural wetland activity through the beaver. They're pretty important. In the Creston Valley, this is some pretty neat example of what's happening so far. The management area, I trap bears down here and completely fell in love. There's nothing more fun than watching a bear wake up and forgetting him and then going off watching turtles and wood ducks. And it just made me fall in love with the whole thing. But it is a magnificent area that we've done several pretty interesting analyses and approaches. Here we hired Greg Utzig, sort of a regional super ecologist who's turned into a climate strategist and a climate modeler for our region. And he did some of this work for the Nature Conservancy, and we've sort of plugged into it. And here he's identified a climate corridor up through the states, up the west side of the valley, that would then need to sort of cross over our ecological corridor in the middle and then continue up Kootenay Lake, the east side. And he had identified these independently of our effort. We didn't put them up to this, but anyway, you can just see it comes together into a nice package. And so some of our future planning will be how to manage these habitats south, in the middle of, and to the north of for climate resilience. And note here, just for a moment, we're going to look at interhydrologic connectivity. So we're going to hold the valley in the water, keep it a little cooler as things dry out. I got a little phone call in the middle of my talk here. Sorry about that. I'm going to take it if you don't mind. No, I'm just kidding. So here's a sub-project that Kootenay Connect through the Nature Fund funded this year. Marc-André Boucher figured out that they had some long-term plans to go in and improve the connectivity of the water sources in the valley. And they went in and dredged some of the channels in the red here and went over into the breeding grounds of the northern leopard frog. And we did this last fall. We were in a rush. We had 7 months to do a year's worth of work. And so we were, you know, looking for some shovel-ready on-the-ground projects. And this was one of the ones that jumped out at Mark, and he put it together and implemented it. And so this is what the channel looked like before. It was just growing in thick with vegetation and inhibiting the water flow between and making the, simplifying the wetlands. And this is what it looked like when they got done at the end of the season. And they were, as they were digging it, the contractor was saying, hey, the water's flowing in and among and around me. He was just watching it occur as it happened. This is the area that was the target where they wanted the water to flow to revitalize the wetland aspect of this area. And this is what it looked like after they got done. It really worked. Mark did an amazing job at picking out a perfect little spot. And really cool part of the story is, so this year, every year, the Northern Leopard Frog Recovery Team, Irene Manley and Leah Randall and Barb Houston and Marc-André and a bunch of people went out, and they go out and look for egg masses. And they found, I just kept getting emails in the spring how many egg masses they were finding right where they did the treatment area. So they were pretty excited. They found enough that they've actually had some, I don't want to call them excess, but they felt like there was enough to move it up to another breeding site they're trying to establish in the Briscoe area. I was just up looking at that site last week. So this is sort of a lucky early kind of success, and we're pretty excited about it. These are sort of some of the things that that we would like to prosper. But remember, we're helping leopard frogs, but remember the climate resilience was also to enhance that intra-wetland hydrologic connectivity. I'm going to get that down eventually, to slow down the water and increase our climate resilience. So these things are all woven together or dovetailed quite nicely. It's kind of impressive. So Marcy and I took all this year's information that we've got, and we've sort of updated that initial report. We've got a year one annual report that summarizes a lot of everything that I've said here today, and we'll probably have a report for every 3 or 4 years, next 3 or 4 years as we finish up. And this was a slide that I left in for the government, but I just want to say here, what can they do? Because I feel like in a way that it's the hardest nut to crack. They just usually tell you what, I can't do this, I can't do that. But we're here to kind of nudge them along into a paradigm shift because it's sort of happening around the world. We might need a new policy designation where we create these wildlife corridors. And this requires a lot of cross-jurisdictional conversations. We need to identify and designate these corridors and enhance and restore them. But again, this requires this cross-jurisdictional conversation. And we're here to try to be a medium for that, if you will. And we can bring a lot of the players. It's amazing, almost everybody thinks this is a neat idea. So hopefully we'll be able to help along this process. And I think that is pretty much my talk. I don't, you guys don't need to hear me anymore. I'd like to recognize our supporters financially. And if you're not on the list, I apologize. Things like this take a lot of money and a lot of time. There's been a lot of sponsors, and we're really excited to have the Wildlife Society here as a co-host, bring in the larger biological community of British Columbia. So that's really one of the neat parts about this talk today. So thank you very much. And we can, I guess we can have questions and suggestions and how we can prove what we're doing. So thanks a lot, everyone.
Thanks so much, Michael. That was a really great talk and a lot to fit in. So yeah, have a glass of water there. I also want to thank our funders that are part of Kootenay Connect that enable match, because we have, as Michael said, $2 million that have come in from Environment Canada and Climate Change to the Canada Nature Fund. But as part of our due diligence, we had to come up with a one-to-one match. So I just also want to acknowledge that the Fish Wildlife Compensation Program and Habitat Conservation Trust Foundation and the Columbia Basin Trust and other funders in our region are all a part of that picture. So so know that Michael and I and KCP, we all see that we're all making this happen. So just want to make sure funders feel appreciated too. And we've got a couple of questions. So I ask you, please, if you have any, to put your question in the Q&A box. And here we go, Michael. So we've got someone wondering about highway crossing structures in the East Kootenay, for example, in the Wycliffe area. What are some of your thoughts there in terms of enhancing connectivity?
Well, interesting that you bring that up, because the Department of Transportation, the Ministry of BC Ministry of Department of Transportation heard this talk I did to the government a couple of weeks ago and immediately sent me a t-shirt about how he won an award for connectivity conservation initiative with the Department of Transportation. So they've long been on our list and a very important part of this. They're not really a big deal for grizzly bears right now because the traffic isn't that high. Grizzly bear problems are centered around people living along the edges, but all the other critters, and it's a really important thing, and it's in our long-term vision. It's really a challenge to get going. The grizzly bear crossings, or just the wildlife crossing structures you see in Banff National Park, what you see are the big ones over the highway, but underneath all that is a whole spectrum of types, from small to medium to large to light to dark to accommodate the ecological needs and security needs of a whole spectrum of nature. So that's a very good question, and something that is not put in this talk and is on our list to incorporate. It's a long-term thing, because they usually don't fix up highways until they're, you know, rebuilding them or something. But that's sort of coming for Highway 3 in British Columbia. The twinning of that highway is being discussed. They're also twinning Highway 1 up at the, you know, the north end of our region. So I don't have a perfect answer for you, but it's an extremely important corner of what we're doing. And so I appreciate the push in that direction.
Great. So another question is, have the food habits of bears changed with corridors restoration?
Well, that's an interesting question. The food habits have changed for a grizzly bear. The biggest food habit change in the last 100 years, and probably the only food habit change, is the loss of salmon in our valleys. Like, they used to come all the way up into Horse Thief Creek and the East Kootenays. And so that's just part of the fragmentation that caused a lot of the grizzly bear fragmentation. And then my hook into fish wildlife compensation program a decade ago was that the dams have changed the valley bottom ecology and the fish and all that. So that's big part of the fragmentation. But the corridor, you know, in terms of corridors, you know, we predict corridors on the best bear habitat in the valley bottoms, and that is related to food. And so those types of food, like in the Creston Valley, are two types: the natural foods in the spring in the Creston management area, and that hasn't changed for millennia. It's still a wonderful spring food source. What has changed, and what is a little bit a problem as well it is as a solution, is the human food source from agriculture. Those bears come in and love the corn, and now we have a lot of bears living in the Creston Valley, basically living off that corn. So it's been a bit of a good thing, because as we take over the valley bottoms and use them for agriculture, of course, wildlife benefits from that by getting a lot of their calories, good, bad, or ugly, from some of those agriculture products. But in some cases, it is a challenge for other reasons, because it's sort of holding the bears down there a little bit longer than I would like to see. So, that's a good question. How do we relate corridor to bear foods, but also, you know, other foods and the needs and the foraging habit needs of all the different species that we have, and how are they changed? How is the, you know, Williamson sapsucker changed their foraging needs, having all the brushy habitats, and a lot of the food habits have changed. So this is really a complex endeavor, and that's what I tried to learn from the grizzly bears. It's not just one thing. We had to go from food modeling to non-lethal management to land purchase to, you know, to private land enhancement. So it's part of the equation.
Okay, great. Here's another one. Are there any specific published resources that you think would be useful to review in establishing guidelines at a local government level for corridors and crossings, particularly in more urban areas?
Well, there are. It is a place to start is, and it will be available publicly very soon, like they said, by July, that report that I talked about, the IUCN Conservation Specialist Group. They have, the report is mostly examples. There's about 20 pages of text with a lot of pictures. It's very easy to read, but they have an amazing amount of examples. And some of those are, because I was reading through them, I was one of their reviewers for the IUCN, are urban corridors and connectivity. And there's a whole host of resources out there. Paul Beyer out of California, he's an Arizona prof, has done a lot of work about corridor design. And now it's every week I get a new email about a new software package trying to predict and estimate corridor in and among urban and semi-rural development. So I can't give you a list right here off the top of my head, but there is a lot out there, and I encourage you. I've got a bunch of it in my computer, but there's a lot of information out there about it. Once you dive into this topic, you'll say, oh, wow, the train has left the station. You know, we're just sort of jumping on the train as it's whisked by our town here.
So, Michael, the government had been considering species at risk legislation, and it seems to have moved off the table recently. And just wondering if you know what's going on with that legislation, and if it's still being worked on, or if it really is off the table for a while.
Well, I'm the wrong guy to ask that question, because I don't know the answer. Bill Harrower might know better. I do know, I think it's off the table early on the process when we got wind of it, I took the Kootenay Connect idea was a bit more in its infancy, a lot more in its infancy. So I set up a special webinar similar to what we just talked about right here without any of the results. And we went through these ideas to potentially incorporate that into that larger document. Because while the government is planning, this is a great time to get some of these ideas in. And I looked at when they, and I'm not sure why they got off the, that came off, was taken off the table. But as everything, I saw a positive spin to that. I thought, oh, good. Now if they get it back on the table, and no pressure, Bill, but I hope they do, it would be nice to integrate some of these landscape level plans into that. Because if we're going to do wildlife management, we're doing habitat management. And this really is habitat management. So I can't answer you on the whys and wheres. It would be nice to know. And I don't want to try to answer something I don't know the answer. Maybe in a minute at the end here, Bill can pipe up and tell us where it's at.
Okay. So here's a question about traditional knowledge and how that might be informing ecological corridors and supporting biodiversity exchange from First Nations stories or other forms of knowledge.
It's integrated into almost everything we do, and it's a bit of a challenge to bring the two cultures together. I mean, you know, we've been sort of the big brother bully for the last 100 years, so rightfully so. We are working with the First Nations as much as we can in each one of our corridors. I'm pretty sure the ONA group is working with the Columbia Wetlands people very intimately. We've had the Tanaha group out of in the Wycliffe area. It comes to all our meetings and has agreed to work with us and put some input in. I was just on a webinar with Marc Andre in the Creston area, and Norm Allard was there from the Lower Kootenay Band, and he's got nothing but good ideas from his traditional knowledge. A lot of the land in the Creston Valley that is owned by the Tanaha Lower Kootenay Band is wetlands, and I know that the grizzly bears love it. My telemetry data has them all over the place, so we've started quite a dialogue. So they're integrated into the process the whole way, and I'm not going to say that it works perfectly. The cultures try to work together, and I think conservation is a place for the two cultures to get along, because I think the conservation community cares about conservation, and the First Nations and Indigenous people really care a lot. So I think it's a great opportunity to for our country and the whole world to work together better, and we are trying, and we communicate with them regularly.
Okay, great. Here's another one. We have a person who's a social scientist on the webinar, and is wondering if there's a study of private land participation in response to projects that are successful over time and can help recruit greater support due to the socioeconomic and socio-ecological benefits that come from the work you're doing.
Well, we've got a smart group out there today. Can we have some more easy questions, please? Just kidding. That's another terrific idea. I work with a social scientist out of Alberta on some other things I do. I'm on a foundation advisory council. And I actually requested we bring her in because she was so effective at understanding the full process of integrating social science and community-based work into the planning and implementation, but also into the measuring of the real effects of it. And we are at this point, I can't speak because I think Juliet and the Kootenay Conservation Program may be further along in those arenas than I am. But this is a, extremely important part of this. One of our goals is to work with community-based conservation. And one of the reasons it was such a good match to work with Kootenay Conservation Program is they are plugged into a lot of stewardship groups and interest groups. So it's sort of built into the fabric of our DNA of how we work. But I can't say that we've got a social scientist on board, and it's another good idea that came out of this. put it on our list, Marcy and Juliet, we should consider it. It's a good suggestion, and I don't have a perfect answer for you.
Okay, and here's one about huckleberries. So is there any evidence to suggest that humans picking huckleberries negatively impacts grizzly bears?
We don't have any direct evidence, but it's a good question, and we've done some been involved in the government response to the commercial huckleberry picking. And I, like 4 years ago, I got an email every 20 minutes telling me, sometimes from the border guards at the Kingsgate, telling me how many bushels of huckleberries were being shipped back into the U.S. by commercial huckleberry pickers. And then I started realizing that most of these were out of the threatened populations up against the border. So I wrote a letter to the powers that be and suggested that we look into that closer, and they did. And the next year they put up a temporary huckleberry, commercial huckleberry ban on in certain areas. The really neat part about this is the next year they came to me and took my huckleberry modeling data and used that to identify the patches they would close off for the commercial huckleberry pickers. And this was a really neat blend of science. And I've been working with these guys, Mike Knappick, who's now retired, and Krebs and the crew still works there. They were plugged in that we had a good huckleberry layer. We all got together, used science to put in an effective barrier. And this last year they came to me and we redrew the boundaries to make them a little more accurate. And so that's about as far as we've gone on that. As far as private pickers, I know they have a limit. I think you're supposed to get 10 liters a year or 10 gallons a year. I'm not sure. I only pick huckleberries on those banner years. Last year, it was an unbelievable year. I picked huckleberries for like 3 years. But so, you know, it's a good question. And we're on it from a commercial huckleberry picking standpoint. Not sure that when the huckleberries come in the prolific year, there is no limit. It's only in the years where they're not so good that there can be a limit.
Okay, and so Roger Dunlop has put a comment in here that they're developing a salmon parks and corridors in Nootka Sound and Nootchuck tribes, into the marine area as well. And so I was appreciating your talk and ideas and wondering if we can share a copy of your PowerPoint for references.
100%, yes. Yes. And they're taping this and putting it on a YouTube, but I'd be happy to make a PDF and send it along as well. That's great. It's cool to hear.
Great. Well, thanks so much, Michael. There's been a lot of questions to field here. And for those of you who need to get on with your day, I just want to thank you all for attending and let you know that we have recorded this, and so it will be available as a link. You will get an email in the next day or two. With that, it'll also be this PowerPoint, and I encourage you to check out the Kootenay Connect webpage at kootenayconservationprogram.ca. There's much more information about this initiative. And Bill, do you want to say anything in terms of closing out on behalf of the Wildlife Society?
No, I just want to say thanks to Mike, really, and everybody for your great questions and participation. Mike, it's always a joy to interact with you, and thanks for giving such a great talk and supporting all the great work.
Okay. All right, thank you. Thanks, everybody, for coming and listening, and we'll talk soon.
Thanks, everyone. Have a great afternoon.